You don't express all of your genes all the time, and neither do bacteria. Hi, biology friends. It's Sarah, your other biology professor, and let's talk about the Lac Operon. Different classes focus on different aspects of the Lac Operon, so we'll do this in parts so you can sort of customize, choose your own adventure. This first video, it's for everyone. We're going to talk about the structure of the Lac Operon, what the different components are and what they do, and how lactose availability controls expression of the Lac Operon. And towards the end of this video, we'll see why the Lac Operon is described as a negative inducible operon, and I'll clear up a couple of common misconceptions. In a second video, we'll look at catabolite repression. So if you need to know about the role of glucose in regulating the Lac Operon, you'll want to check that one out. And finally, in a third video, we'll look at some of the repercussions of mutations in the Lac Operon. All of the links to the videos are in the description, and you can also find them at the end of this video. But before we can layer on details, you need to understand the basics of the Lac Operon. An operon is a way to organize genes whose products function in the same pathway by putting those genes together under the control of a single promoter. Operons are a great example of how gene expression, that multi-step process of going from gene to a functional product, can be regulated at the level of transcription. The lactose operon, or lac operon in E. coli, contains genes necessary for the metabolism of the sugar lactose. In the lac operon, three protein-coding genes, or structural genes, are organized back-to-back under the control of a single promoter, often labeled P or lacP in diagrams. Remember, the promoter is where RNA polymerase will bind in order to initiate transcription. In between the promoter and the structural genes, you'll find a sequence called the operator, lacO or O on diagrams. And the operator is a site where proteins can bind in order to regulate expression of the lac operon. And that's your basic operon structure. When the lac operon is on, or expressed, the structural genes are transcribed to produce a single mRNA, or polycistronic mRNA, that will be translated to produce three enzymes involved in metabolizing the sugar lactose. So starting with the closest to the promoter, lacZ encodes beta-galactosidase, an enzyme involved in breaking lactose, a disaccharide, into two monosaccharides, and it also does something else we'll see a bit later. Next is lacY, which encodes a permease. This is going to allow lactose to enter the cell. And finally, lacA. We're not totally sure how the enzyme encoded by lacA is involved in lactose metabolism. It may have a detoxification function. So honestly, some classes just skip it. But what we do know is that the cell doesn't just keep pumping out these enzymes all of the time. When would the cell not want to make the lactose metabolizing enzymes? When there's no lactose around to metabolize. So the cell regulates or controls transcription based on a condition, lactose availability. No lactose available, no transcription, no production of the structural genes enzymes. So for now, let's say that expression, transcription of the lac operon, is off when lactose is not available and on when lactose is available, right? It's the lac operon, lactose turns it on. Ooh, but how? Let's start with a no lactose scenario, right? So if we don't have lactose available, the cell doesn't need to transcribe the structural genes to make enzymes to break down something that's not there. So expression is off, but why is it off? Well, just upstream of the promoter, but not part of the operon itself, you'll find another gene, a regulatory gene. This gene is called lacI. And it is expressed constitutively. That means all the time. It's not dependent on lactose concentration. So transcription of this gene is always on, unaffected by lactose levels. What's the E. coli making here? Well, it's producing an mRNA that encodes a repressor protein called the lac repressor. Repressor sounds like something that wants to shut something down. Well, the lac repressor is produced in an active state, meaning it comes out ready to repress transcription of the lac operon. But how does it do that? Well, when there's no lactose available, our newly created and active lac repressor is going to bind to the operator sequence. Remember that the operator overlaps the promoter just a little bit, so that when the repressor protein is bound to the operator, that's going to block RNA polymerase from being able to come in, bind to the promoter, and initiate transcription. And that's kind of perfect, because if there's no lactose to metabolize, does the cell really need to be making a bunch of product from the lactose metabolizing structural genes? There's no lactose to play with, there's nothing for them to do, so no need to waste a bunch of energy. Cool, but what happens when conditions change? When lactose does become available, the cell's going to need to turn on transcription of those structural genes. So how does that switch from off to on happen? Well, look at the operon here. What needs to change in order to be able to transcribe the structural genes? We've got to get that repressor out of the way. Enter a molecule called an inducer, a type of effector, a small molecule that binds to a regulatory protein and alters its activity. When the repressor binds to the inducer, that causes a change of shape in the repressor protein, a conformational change. So with that conformational change, the DNA binding site that the repressor uses to bind to the operator is no longer open. It's lost its affinity for binding the operator. So when the inducer molecule is present, it binds to the repressor, effectively inactivating the repressor. The repressor is no longer bound to the operator, and RNA polymerase's path is cleared up. So RNA polymerase can now access the promoter and initiate transcription of the structural genes. That's why this little molecule is called an inducer. To induce means to start something up, and here we're starting up transcription. So when the inducer is present, transcription of the lactose metabolizing structural genes gets started. So what might be a good inducer here? Maybe lactose? Maybe. All right, real quick, if your class calls lactose the inducer, take a break for a second. I gotta talk to everybody else. All right, so technically the natural inducer is not lactose, but allolactose. Allolactose is derived from lactose. It's an isomer of lactose. You're just switching up that little bond. This is the other thing that beta-galactosidase does. So when lactose enters the cell, a small portion of that will be converted by beta-galactosidase into allolactose. That allolactose is going to bind quite nicely to the lac repressor, inactivate it, free up that operator, and get transcription going. But for the sake of simplicity, right, when you're looking at models and such, some classes just like to keep things a little bit more simple and just call lactose the inducer. So when lactose is available, it's going to be brought into the cell by permease. Beta-galactosidase is going to convert some of that into allolactose. That's our inducer. The operator is going to be freed up due to the repressor being inactivated. We've got transcription going. We are producing structural gene mRNA products and proteins to break down lactose, and our lactose levels start to drop because we're metabolizing it. We're breaking it down, and eventually, we're going to run out of lactose. So what happens now? Less lactose also means less allolactose, less inducer to bind up repressor. Now we're going to have active repressor roaming around. That's going to bind to the operator and turn off expression of those structural genes. Because why keep making enzymes for lactose metabolism when there's no more lactose around? This type of regulation is called negative inducible gene regulation. Negative because when our regulatory protein, the repressor, binds to the operon DNA, transcription goes down, expression goes down. There's a negative impact on expression levels. And inducible because the default state of the lac operon is basically in the off position. Remember, that repressor gets produced in an active state, but the lac operon can be induced, transcription can be turned on, through the presence of that inducer molecule, allolactose. And if you want to learn more about positive, negative, inducible, and repressible operons, I have a whole other video just on that. Lactose availability inactivates the repressor molecule, allowing transcription to occur, whereas in the absence of lactose, the repressor stays active and blocks transcription. Now, many classes will talk about the lac operon being off when the levels of lactose are too low to inactivate the repressor. In fact, that's what I just did. But in reality, the lac operon is never 100% off. There's always at least a little bit of transcription happening. But why? Well, the active lac repressor isn't 100% effective at binding to the operator. It can fall off. And when that happens, RNA polymerase is ready to sneak in and get a little bit of transcription done. So what we'll see here is what's often described as leaky transcription, background expression levels, like a drip, drip, drip of a faucet, very low levels of expression. But why keep those leaky expression levels going, even when there's no lactose around to metabolize? Lactose is a disaccharide, and you may remember from your cell membrane unit that it's going to need a protein in order to enter the cell. LacY produces permease, lactose permease, the protein that allows for lactose to enter the cell. So by keeping some permease around, we're ready should lactose become available in the cellular environment. Having that leaky bit of expression of the structural genes also assures that there's a little bit of beta-galactosidase available in order to convert lactose into allolactose as soon as permease starts bringing that into the cell, making that inducer molecule, allolactose, that's going to be able to inactivate the repressor and allow us to kickstart transcription of the structural genes to make more enzymes to break down all this newfound lactose. So maybe instead of off, a better way to think of the lac operon in those no lactose conditions is repressed. So by now, I know that you know that the lac operon is repressed when there's no lactose available. But transcription can be induced, started up, when lactose is around. But that's not the whole story. Stick around for part two to see the role of glucose in regulating expression of the lac operon. Or if you've had enough lac operon for today, drop me a like if you learned something about the lac operon. Check out my website for tutoring resources, subscribe for even more biology content from me, and I'll see you next time.